We're here at the Pneuma training. We are in session 3 tonight. I've got a strong burden tonight from the Lord for what we're about to dive into. Just feel His presence here tonight and just really praying for breakthrough and deliverance. Let's pray. Let's just stretch out in agreement. God, we're here tonight. God, have your way. God, we're here tonight. Have your way. Lord, open up the scriptures to us, God.
Thank you.
Pray for a spirit of wisdom and revelation, Lord, that you would enlighten the eyes of our hearts that we might know you better. God, I pray for freedom and deliverance. Freedom and deliverance. Just place your hands over your mind right now. Just really feel this tonight. God, we just pray for freedom. God, we cry out for deliverance tonight, God. Lord, set us free, God, in this place, Lord, from the front row to the back, God. We ask in the name of Jesus, release freedom. God, fill our hearts with love tonight. God, even as we learned last week, Lord, the most excellent way, God, is to exercise the gifts in love toward one another. Romans 5:5, the love of God has been poured out into your heart by the Holy Spirit. Let us not frustrate His love tonight. Let us receive it. Jesus, we just pray for a fresh impartation, a baptism of love. Lord, let love have its way at heart of the Father. Lord, let love have its way in every person that listens by podcast and audio. God, fill our hearts with love for one another. Lord, we break ties with criticism. We say no to the accuser of the brethren. Lord, we say no to the fault-finding spirits. Oh, God, come and cleanse our hearts tonight. God, purge us. God, purge us tonight. God, purge us tonight. Lord, fill our hearts with love for one another. Lord, let love have its way in us tonight. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Man, I just want you to look around this room for a minute and say, welcome, family.
Welcome.
If you made the name of Jesus, whether you've ever seen them or not, we're part of the family of God. And it's just been my desperate heart's cry through these teachings, these trainings, that we would see one another as family. Amen. The title of this session is called Exposing the Accuser of the Brethren and Fault-Finding Spirits. I'm going to begin in Roman numeral 1, emphasis on edification. Throughout 1 Corinthians 12 through 14, which is our text through these 8 weeks, Paul is continuing to instruct the believers in Corinth to earnestly desire spiritual gifts, and especially those that are most beneficial and edifying to the body. I underline this. He establishes that the most excellent way to do this is through a heart full of love toward one another. And I'm just going to say it one last time. We know according to 1 Corinthians 12 through 14 that every believer in Jesus Christ has spiritual gifts. That's the first truth that we need to receive. Secondly, a truth is this, that every gift is needed. So there's not one person in this room that has a spiritual gift from the Lord that this body of believers doesn't need. And I want to just remind you that God doesn't give gifts according to whether we believe in them or not. He gives gifts according to His grace. Amen. I was at the gym today, and there was a gentleman that walked around the corner, and the Holy Spirit just gave me a very clear vision, a word for him. And I walked up to him like I had known him all my life, and I said, "Sir, I'd like to present something to you that you could judge and weigh." And he said, "What in the world could that be?" And I just laid out this vision to him, a very clear word about discipleship, a men's ministry, some problems that he had had in the ministry in the past, and about what God was about to do. And the more I talked, the more his eyes became wider and wider. And I didn't really know how to end the conversation because, quite frankly, he couldn't talk. And I said, "Well, have a great day, what's your name? And he said, I'm so-and-so, I'm a Baptist minister in town, and I've been a bishop for about 30 years. So God basically rocked that guy with the truth that the spiritual gifts are for today, whether he believed in them or not.
Come on.
I guarantee he left that gym saying, wow, prophecy's probably for today. And so God has a way, whether people believe in it or not, of making himself real to us in a way that we can understand. So we all have spiritual gifts. They're all necessary. And then we've read in 1 Corinthians 12, it says 31, but earnestly desire the greater gifts. So we have gifts. They're all important. What are the greater gifts? Greater in this context simply means the most beneficial or the most edifying to the body of Christ. And I gave you an example. If Paul had to choose between someone speaking in tongues, no one can understand them, versus someone that's prophesying in an intelligible language, he would choose prophecy over tongues. Why? Not because prophecy is necessarily more important than tongues, but prophecy is more edifying. It's more beneficial to the body. So even that we all possess gifts, and even that all the gifts are needed, Paul still encourages us to eagerly and earnestly desire greater gifts. So no matter what gifts of the Holy Spirit you possess, we should also too be earnestly pressing the Lord, saying, Lord, use me in the gifts of the Holy Spirit that are most edifying to your body. And then he says one more thing, and now I will show you the most excellent way. Am I talking too fast?
I am.
I'm trying to speed you up. The most excellent way. According to Paul, the most excellent way that the gifts of the Holy Spirit function in community is gifts flowing for the purpose of edification, for the purpose of benefiting others in love. If you could just, I could sum up 1 Corinthians 13, which we talked about last week. Listen, if the gifts of the Holy Spirit are not used in love, they're meaningless. That's why it's so important to cry out to God, fill my heart with love for my brother and sister. We need the love of God to love our wives, to love our children, to love church members. How many people have been struck with that? There's someone that bothers me so much that I know I can't love them unless God helps me. By the way, Jesus said, real love, well, you already love people who love you back. What about loving people who don't love you back? That's real love. The manifestation of loving God is loving others. Let none of us claim that we have a deep, intimate relationship with God and we don't have deep, intimate relationships with people. Okay, that was last week. Praise God. Paragraph 2 here, Paul clearly says that when the gifts of the Holy Spirit are exercised in a way that is not loving, it has no benefit to the body of believers and should be seen as meaningless. Letter A, the spiritual climate in Corinth. We know according to the many issues that Paul specifically addresses at Corinth, these are just a few, honestly. Jealousy, envy, pride, immorality, drunkenness, that they were by no means a perfect church. In fact, they were far from it. It would have been easy for many of the believers to recognize the faults and misgivings of others and make them their priority and focus. Rather than calling them to focus on imperfections of one another, remember the enemy is always trying to get us to take us off his perfection and focus on the imperfection of people. Remember, the enemy is always trying to get us to take our focus off of his perfection and focus on the imperfection of others. Paul challenges them to love and edify one another by exercising the spiritual gifts God had given them. So I gave a little background in session one, okay? This is a pretty jacked up church, okay? Just to give you plain English, okay? The gifts of the Holy Spirit flowed in Corinth, okay? But there was a bunch of immorality. There was a bunch of sin. I don't want you to get the picture that they had it all together. There was plenty to talk about, and Paul addresses a bunch of it. But he's constantly focusing them on loving one another and exercising the gifts that they've been given in love. B, it says, if the heart posture and attitude in which we are to exercise the spiritual gifts God has given us is love for one another, which is a true statement, what we choose not to deal with and repent of in our hearts will not only hinder but distort the purity of the spiritual gifts we have been given. If the heart posture and attitude in which we are to exercise the spiritual gifts God has given us is love for one another, what we choose not to deal with and repent of in our hearts will not only hinder but distort the purity of the spiritual gifts we have been given. Let me give you an example here. It's on your sheet. Try to think of names that wouldn't show up here. If it's you, it's not talking about you, maybe. Susie receives a powerful prophetic word of blessing and encouragement for Bob, who she finds annoying when he worships and rude when he talks to children in the church. If Susie does not address the bitterness and resentment in her heart toward Bob, the word of blessing and encouragement she is supposed to give Bob will be difficult to release and oftentimes tainted by her own opinions of him. As the gifts of the Holy Spirit begin to function and operate in our midst, what we think about people really is always challenged. On my prophetic journey in the Lord, as I've grown some and I'm still growing in many ways, one of the marks, I believe, of a mature prophetic person is that they are able to prophesy to people not according to their opinion of them, but according to what God thinks of them. We have to clean out the filter of our hearts. Do we have prejudices against people? Do we have offense in our hearts toward one another? And I believe one of the ways that God challenges us and brings us up in maturity is he begins to ask us to minister to people, quite frankly, we don't enjoy. Part of the reason, and I'm telling you, trusted prophetic voices are voices that can separate their opinion from what God thinks about them. I'm going to tell you, I have been through season after season where the Lord specifically sent me to people who I had a problem with. I didn't like the way they did this and that. I knew their sin. And the Lord would give me powerful words of encouragement and blessing and promotion. Sometimes it was words that would soar them way beyond even where I currently was. Was I going to let my self-righteousness, was I going to let my judgment, was I going to let my arrogance hinder the word of the Lord? Or was I going to step into the place of purity, repentance, and say, Lord, I repent right now of anything that I've got against them, and I'm going to allow you purely to flow through me in this moment. Beloved, I can't tell you enough, and I feel like I have an opportunity tonight because I'm creating this curriculum through prayer and fasting. Everything that we're going over is what I believe the Lord is saying to us specifically. So we've got an opportunity tonight to address some of these issues. And one of the things I'm finding from the place of prayer is God is way more interested in the attitudes of our heart than he is about releasing spiritual gifts. I'm totally convinced of this. God is way more interested in calling us to repentance and asking us to deal with the deep issues inside of our hearts. We were praying this morning for this meeting, and the Lord gave me a spiritual picture of hidden caves inside of people's hearts. And he was reaching in like he would reach in, and he was pulling like a string and light bulbs coming on. Hidden places in our hearts. judgments that we have against people in this room. We have to deal with these things. We have to confront them if we want God to use us in a pure way. And by the way, this is what's most needed in this movement right now. The pure, unadulterated flow of the Holy Ghost. I can't tell you how many times the Lord has said to me, I'm not asking you about your opinion. I want you to give them the word of the Lord. I don't care what they did to you last week. It doesn't matter what. You need to work on that. And I think in our midst tonight, one of the things that God in His mercy, He's coming toward us and He's saying, if there's anything in my heart towards so-and-so, God, would you deal with it and help me to repent of it so that I could be a pure vessel of the ministry of the Holy Spirit that you want to release through me. Beloved, I'm just not talking about people that are the Father. I'm talking about your friends, your family, your co-workers. Hallelujah. Another example, Billy is impressed by the Lord to give financially to Wendy, who cannot pay her bills. The problem is that Billy thinks Wendy is a poor steward of her finances. And probably, she says too, a terrible mother to her two children. If Billy does not deal and address the criticism and negativity in his heart toward the way Wendy handles her finances or parents her children, Billy will most likely either not give to her at all, thus disobeying the prompting of the Lord, or give to her spitefully and not receive a reward from God altogether. Where do we go from here? Love, there are so many things in our hearts, even subconsciously, that we allow the flesh, we allow the enemy to sow into us about so-and-so. And they're not doing this right, and they haven't done this right. And the Lord's saying, will you just lay all that down and let me use you? I didn't ask you to determine whether they were a good steward of their money or not. That's up to them and me. If God says, give, give. I thank God I got freed from this. Love it. I don't care what they do with the money. I'm just going to be straight up honest with you. Some dude's on the side of the road with a beer in his hand. If God tells me to give him 20 bucks, I'm going to give him 20 bucks. Well, he might spend it on alcohol. Let's just quiet that religious spirit that comes to contend against the voice of God. I'm going to tell you what, the Spirit of the Lord will come. If you'll really take what I'm saying seriously, He will blow you away about how He feels about people you don't like. Oh. He will blow you away about the people that He wants to bless and encourage and restore. But if we've got things in our hearts and we need to clean out our filter, it's something that we've got to deal with. We're dealing tonight, and I just want to take a second here. We're dealing tonight with the accuser of the brethren, and we're dealing tonight with the fault-finding spirits. I know in charismatic circles, we throw around the term spirits a lot. I have been around many people that think there's a spirit in everything and there's a demon under any pot and pan. I might stretch some of you tonight by what I'm about to share, but I'm going to tell you with all seriousness how real what we're talking about tonight is to me personally. I believe that these are real demons and real principalities that come and make their way in the midst of communities of believers with the express purpose of hindering the exercising of the gifts of the Holy Spirit in love. This accuser of the brethren, Satan, who accuses the saints before God day and night, is looking to partner with you and I. The devil is not content at depressing us. He wants to make us an ally. I'm telling you, He wants us to join in His work just as much as God wants us to get in line with His work. This accusing thing where we constantly accuse people and we criticize them in our hearts and we make judgments against them. And we're going to get into this whole false discernment thing. Beloved, I'm going to go after everything I can tonight. But we have to allow the Lord to deal with this accusing thing and this fault-finding spirit where I believe people, some of them, I believe it's they're in a demonic attack. They find a fault with every single person that they meet so that they don't have to get vulnerable with anyone. Isn't it so easy if we can detect the sin and the faults in others so that we can keep ourselves at a distance? Isn't it so easy to find fault with every church in our town so that we don't have to attend? Isn't it easy to find fault with every pastor and leader so that we don't ever have to submit to one in relationship? You guys know that I travel all around the nation and I preach. I'm going to tell you that there are many times when I travel and preach that I encounter demonic principalities that rule regions. This is where I'm going to stretch you a little bit. If you agree with me, fine. If you don't, that's okay. I'm just going to tell you by experience that there are demonic principalities that guard and have dominion over certain regions of the United States. They're real strongholds.
Right.
And I have traveled to several different parts of the United States where in a dream the night before I went, they would come and confront me in a dream. These two large black figures, they each wear armor. This is what I've seen them in these dreams. And they each have breastplates. And one of them says, the accuser of the brethren, and this other demon, it has a breastplate, and it says, the fault-finding spirit. And on multiple occasions, they have said to me, we are the ruling principalities in this region, and you cannot come in here. We control the churches. We have incited competition between the pastors. Beloved, if you don't think this stuff is here in Lakeland, you're crazy. The reason why the Holy Spirit is not flowing in love toward one another is because we have incited them to accuse one another. We have incited them to go jealous of one another. We have incited them to go on all-out rampages to destroy the credibility of a minister or a man. This stuff is real. And I say the same thing to these principalities in the dream, and they leave every time. And I'm going to teach it to you. Thank God it's in the Bible. How many people want to know how to break through and break free of accusation and fault finding? These things come and they try to attack us. This is what I say to them every time. I bind you in the name of Jesus Christ with a love that covers a multitude of sins. I bind you in the name of Jesus Christ with a love. This isn't in your notes. You can just take it for what you will. I bind you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ with a love that covers a multitude of sins. I know some of us are still working on that. Brother, do you know what they've done? Love covers a multitude of sin. Just been praying for a shift here. There's got to be a shift in our midst. With a love that covers a multitude of sins. To pray, P-R-A-Y, for people, rather than pray, P-R-E-Y, on them. I bind you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, with a love that covers a multitude of sin, and a desire to pray for others rather than pray on them. Do you pray or do you pray? This is bottom line where we're at tonight. God is coming in His mercy to confront these two spirits. They might be in your life right now. They might come and meet you in a future season. But it's so important to stand on guard against these spirits. It's important to pray for people, not prey on them. It's important to ask God to fill your heart with a love that covers a multitude of sin so that the Lord Jesus Christ could go and eat dinner with tax collectors and sinners that drove self-righteous Pharisees bonkers. Love covers a multitude of sins. C, relationship anyone. The strength of a judgmental and accusatory spirit is the lack of face-to-face interaction between the two parties involved. The strength of a judgmental and accusatory spirit is the lack of face-to-face interaction between the two parties involved. Offense is always looking to grow and increase among believers who refuse to build relationship with one another. In communities of believers who fail to develop vulnerable and honest relationships, the spirits of accusation and fault-finding will grow in strength. Beloved, this spirit in some people is so strong, they don't have a deep and intimate relationship with anyone to save their life. Really should just look in the mirror, but that was free. Bless you with that. If you are involved in relationships where you cannot share how and why you feel about certain issues, they are unhealthy and dysfunctional. If you are involved in relationships where you cannot share how and why you feel about certain issues, they are unhealthy and dysfunctional. Parents, if your children cannot come to you and speak to you openly about issues in their life, something is wrong. Husband, if your wife cannot come to you and speak openly with you about issues on your heart, something is wrong. In a community of believers, if there are issues, if there is strife, if there is disagreement, let's go to one another instead of talk about one another. Many individuals specifically attempt to find faults and grounds to accuse so they don't have to build strong relationships. They make the spirits of accusation and fault-finding friends instead of foes. Jesus released freedom tonight. Roman numeral 2, praying and intercession. A, the call to pray. One of the strongest safeguards that God has given the saints to battle the accuser of the brethren and fault-finding spirits is the weapons of intercession and prayer. Listen, it's really hard to talk about people when you're busy praying for them. Praying for them, not praying on them. Just say that one more time because it's good. It's really hard to talk and bash people when you're busy praying for them. Listen, I'm just of the opinion that if we would spend half as much time praying for Obama than praying on him, we might see some real change. I mean, goodness gracious, we've got more people that are exercising and partnering with the accuser of the brethren and a fault-finding spirit rather than praying for the man. Here's what I love to do. When I've got an offense and I've got an issue towards someone, I go in the place of prayer, and it's the perfect place to let out the flesh and the spirit and come out of that place actually in the spirit. Because what a lot of people do is they've got an offense, they harboring an issue, and they just ding, 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 let's go at it. And they start going back and forth and pulling out the guns and the knives and saying stuff they wish they would have never said and walking away saying, where in the world did that come from? Anybody ever been in those conversations? You got so mad you thought, wow, I've got issues. Where in the world did that come from? Come on. We're going to be religious. I mean, how many? There's some stuff down inside of here that if somebody catches me on a wrong day, like the morning, just kidding, pretty nice in morning prayer. God bless you. Even wear my sweatpants. We've got to get into the place of prayer. Beloved, when you feel this accusatory, this fault-finding thing, when you've got judgment and criticism in your heart, beloved, let's pray for Joel Osteen, not pray on the God. Literally, it just drives me nuts. And I think that social media, so many times, it's like a tool to get you to partner with evil. I mean, so many times, the media has a way of stirring up stuff about so-and-so. People don't even have an idea what's going on. They've never met them. They've never had a conversation with them. And all of a sudden, they're a partner with the accuser and the fault-finding spirit, and they don't even know the facts. I mean, people get riled up and fired up, and you ask them, people, what do you think about Joel Osteen? Honestly, I've never met the guy. I don't know him. I don't really have an opinion. I'll just pray for him. Hey, whatever. If you know him and you want to call him false, this and that, go for it. But beloved, when I choose to really pray for people, the Holy Spirit has a way of cleaning our filter. He has a way of taking out soulish judgments and criticisms and giving us an opportunity to pray for people. Hallelujah. God, let this commence in our midst. These two spirits will incite individuals to spend weeks unearthing old faults or sins in their ministry, church, or people they relate to. The people who are held captive by these deceitful spirits become crusaders, irreconcilable enemies of their former churches and relationships. In most cases, the things they deem wrong or lacking are the very areas in which the Lord seeks to position them for intercession. What might otherwise be an opportunity for spiritual growth and meeting a need becomes an occasion of stumbling and withdrawal. In truth, their criticisms are a smokescreen for a heart without prayer and an unwillingness to serve and be reconciled to one another. The spirits of accusation and fault-finding must be replaced with prayer and a love that covers a multitude of sins. Remember that prayer that I prayed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I bind you with a love that covers a multitude of sin and the desire to pray for you rather than pray on you. God could very well be showing you the sins of others, but not as ammunition against them, but as information on how to pray for and love them. There's so many important points tonight, okay? I have worked with so many prophetic people, as I call them. We haven't broken down the gifts yet. There's a gift, it's some translations say discernment. Really a better translation is distinguishing of spirits. But there are people that have a spiritual gift where they, you know, oh, something's wrong with that person. Oh, I just get a feeling. Oh, they're a pervert. Oh, I mean, you know, I've been down the line with a lot of different type of people that there's just something wrong. And this and this and that. And one of the things that I want to say publicly is I really do believe that God has given the gift of discernment or distinguishing of spirits to certain individuals that help them or release to them the sins of other people. They can see it clearly. There are some people that I know, they won't even get around these people because they feel convicted. But here's the thing. God hasn't shown you the sins of others so you can get some ammunition in your gun and fire on them. He's showing you their sins as information to pray for them. I mean, if we could just make this manifest in marriages, they would be a lot healthier. Yes, wife, that nasty thing you're seeing in your husband, that you don't need to use that to tear him down. Pray and ask God to build him up in that area. I'm talking to anyone. But we get on, oh my gosh, did you see that about so-and-so? Shh, have you prayed for them yet? I mean, we just want to make it public. Oh, that guy, this guy. See, the thing I'm telling you about the accusing and the fault finding is it loves friends. Hey, did you hear about so-and-so? Hey, here. And all of a sudden, we got a little posse of accusers and fault finders in the name of the Lord, and we're going to go on some mercenary journey to destroy the character and integrity of someone rather than calling a prayer meeting and saying, gosh, did you see their sin? I'm not going to use it as ammunition to fire in them. Let's get into a place of prayer and pray for breakthrough. Or should I get into, wow, doesn't it feel good when we see sins in other people and we don't have that sin? Well, it looks like I'm doing good. I'm going to go there. That self-righteous spirit that comes on us, we love to hear about the sins of other people because it makes us feel better about ourselves. You know anybody like that? I know a ton of people. They love to hear that other people are struggling. Jesus gives the example where two men come. One guy says, thank God I'm not like that guy. Another guy beats his chest and says, forgive me, God, I'm a sinner. Beloved, I'm telling you, so many people come to church with a self-righteous attitude and say, thank God I'm not like them out there. Instead of saying, God, I receive your mercy and grace for my sin tonight. Tell me, the heart of the Pharisee says, thank God I'm not like them. The only thing that separates us from anyone else, the only thing that separates us from that guy that walked into the Bible study last night and shot 9 people, you know what separates you from them? Not your righteousness. It's called the grace of God. Hallelujah. Are you surprised by what you see in others? Look in the mirror. You don't have it all together either. Good grief. This is the deception of these spirits. We get so caught up in the dysfunction of others that we can't even see our own. I want to release a prophetic word to you right now that the Holy Spirit gave to me. It's called Beware of the Whisperer. I want to give you a prophetic word right now as I've studied this week in prayer. You can take it, write it down. But I'm telling you, the Lord is saying either to this church or he's saying to someone here tonight, the Holy Spirit is saying to you, beware of the whisperer. In Proverbs chapter 26, it says this. Verse 20, for lack of wood, the fire goes out. And where there is no whisperer, contention quiets down. Like charcoal to hot embers and wood to fire, so is a contentious man to kindle strife. The words of a whisperer are like dainty morsels, and they go down into the innermost parts of the body. Like an earthen vessel overlaid with silver dross are burning lips and a wicked heart. He who hates disguises it with his lips, but he lays up deceit in his heart. When he speaks graciously, do not believe him, for there are 7 abominations in his heart. I'm telling you that there's a whispering spirit that the enemy is releasing right now. And this whisperer is going to come to you and whisper about so-and-so in secret. I'm telling you, beloved, we have a responsibility as believers in Jesus Christ to shut down gossip, to shut down slander. Do not listen to it. It will poison your spirit. Do not listen to gossip. Do not listen to slander. If they have a problem with so-and-so, go talk to them. Stop poisoning my well. I'm telling you one more time. the deception of the whispering, fault-finding, accusing spirit is it's incessantly looking for friends. Somebody come. Somebody come. Help justify my emotions. Here, share in my rage. Share in my frustration. And you begin to get mad and frustrated with so-and-so when you're not even involved in the situation. All of a sudden, we're taking up an offense for someone else. And I'm telling you, there's so many lies out there. You hear a lie about so-and-so. It's a bold-faced lie. Oh, they're a thief. No, they're not. You don't even know the story. So, did you know that so-and-so stole and so-and-so stole? And all of a sudden, oh, so-and-so, they're a thief. Beloved, they could be innocent, and you're choosing to sin with this person and not pray for them. Are you hearing me tonight? Beware of the whisper. I just believe the Lord is saying to this community, He's saying to someone tonight, be on the alert for people that are going to come and whisper to you in secret people's sins. Shut them down. Do not participate in this wickedness again that comes to hinder the flow of the Holy Spirit. How in the world can you be talking about so-and-so at your house on Wednesday night and minister to them in love on Sunday morning? You can't do it. We want to know why there's not more movement of the Holy Ghost. We want to know why the gifts of the Holy Spirit are not functioning in the American church. I'll tell you why. It's a love problem. It's a relationship problem. Here in Lakeland, I'll tell you something. I've never met more people in one city that don't even like the church they attend or the leader. I've never met more people in one city than Lakeland, Florida, who do not even like the pastor or the church that they attend. My question is, what in the world are you doing? I'm going to take it down a few notches. I see some people like this. I'm really not mad. I'm just passionate to see the gifts of the Holy Spirit flourish in our midst, and they are never going to flow as God desired so long as these two spirits reign and rule in our hearts. And I can tell you by experience, it's a daily journey. Oh, the enemy is constantly looking to lay seed in our heart. He's looking to bring about strife. He's looking. I've met people, they've never met the person and they don't like them. They've never met the person and they don't like them. Be false discernment. If we are ever going to exercise the true spiritual gift of distinguishing of spirits, we're going to have to crucify our instincts to judge and accuse others. We must uproot thought systems that have not been planted in the divine soil of faith and love for people. We must uproot thought systems that have not been planted in the divine soil of faith and love for people. Without divine forgiveness constantly working in our hearts toward those we are in relationship with, we will exercise the spiritual gifts God has given us from a place of deception. We will believe we are moving in discernment when in truth we are operating in an accusing and fault-finding spirit. Discovering the imperfections of a church leader, church, or church member is by no means a sign of spirituality. We could do that before we were even Christians. What we do with what we see, however, is the measure of Christ-like maturity. What we do with what we see is the measure of Christ-like maturity. Remember, when Jesus saw the condition of mankind, He died to take away their sins. He did not just judge and accuse them. Francis Frangipane says, we have no right to judge anyone unless we're willing to die for them. I'll let you free. I didn't put that on your paper. I don't have to remember that. Hallelujah. Roman numeral 3. Our heart toward one another. Are you with me tonight?
Yes, sir.
Oh, it's heavy. Take your sheet home.
Praise the Lord.
Our thoughts and attitude of the heart toward those in our midst, this is one of the great keys tonight, should always be faith working toward love. Beloved, your heart toward those that you're in relationship with should always be faith working toward love. You need a scripture reference, Galatians 5, 6. Remember, Satan never offers hope nor extends grace for repentance to anyone. Remember, Satan never offers hope nor extends grace for repentance to anyone. His goal is to harm, not heal. What's our goal for one another? It's a real simple to ask yourself. We get into a service and we say, we're going to begin to let the gifts of the Holy Spirit flow. My first suggestion would be, cry out to the Lord and ask Him to fill your heart with love. Number two, ask yourself a question. Is my heart filled with faith working toward love for the person that I'm about to minister to? But some way in the American church, we've created paradigms of ministry where, quite frankly, we don't need to be in relationship with anyone to minister to them. So many church leaders are just looking to make a buck off the people of God rather than love them and shepherd them. So many worshipers, so many, just let me get up there and play my spiritual gift and just walk out the door, and who cares who knows me? Should I start doing this to you guys again?
Come on.
I know it's exciting. The gifts of the Holy Spirit, trust me, I'm like ready for week 4. I mean, let me talk about prophecy. Trust me, I can talk for 52 weeks. I mean, I'm ready. But if our hearts are not full of love toward one another, it's all in vain. We can prophesy, we can have the Holy Ghost come, and we're all slaying the spirit of Jonah, whatever. But if we're not in love relationship with one another, we're like a clanging cymbal. So there's a call to maturity. I said it last week, I just feel led to say it again. The greatest anointing that the Spirit can release to our lives is the anointing to love God with all that we have and love others as ourselves. I've been in services all over the world where there is literally an anointing being released for everything but that. I mean, from... if you want the A.A. Allen anointing to, if you want the whoever mantle, or if, I mean, whatever, we make up stuff that's not in the Bible. You want the 414 anointing for $414 and whatever. Lord, I'm here today and I ask that you would anoint me.
Whoa.
I felt that. To anoint me to love you with everything that I have and to love other people. Again, I spoke last week, we've got to view love in the light of the judgment seat of Christ. When we get to that great day, I believe one of the final questions He's going to ask us is this: did you learn how to love? Well, did you see how I prophesied, and did you see how I preached in India? well, I gave you those gifts anyway, so did you learn how to love? A, the rebuker syndrome. There are some members of the body of Christ who believe their job is to bring rebuke and correction to anyone or anything in the church that is not operating according to what they believe is a biblical standard. They spend more time praying on the saints, that's the EY, than praying AY for the saints. They spend more time praying on the saints than praying for the saints, and typically move on to another group once their accusations and assessments are ignored or they aren't taken seriously. These people are obsessed with the dysfunction in others and can rarely see their own. Book of Proverbs says, have you seen a man that's wise in his own eyes? There's more hope for a fool than him. They are like piranhas, jumping at the first sight of a perceived problem that they believe they are called to expose and let everyone know about. Beware, they come to hurt, not heal, and destroy, not bring life. Like the Pharisees, they are hard on everyone else and easy on their own character issues. Do you have an issue with your brother and sister in your church community? Stop talking about them, but go to them. This is laid out so clear in Matthew 18. Jesus specifically addresses offenses amongst believers. Go to them. Now, I know it's the fear of man. I know it's the fear of rejection. I know it's the fear of confrontation. There we can talk about all the fears of why we don't go to, but I'm telling you, if we want to be Bible-believing saints, those that are walking in maturity, we've got to stop talking about people and get a meeting with them face-to-face. Again, the strength of an accusing, judgmental spirit is found in the lack of face-to-face interaction with those who are at odds with one another. Isn't the internet a great venue for this? You can blast people on the internet and then see them at church and, oh, praise God, how you doing, brother? Liar. We create all these venues where we speak well of others with our lips and then our hearts loving all that stuff. I'm telling you how God upgrades us in maturity is He's going to ask you to pray for that person you got beef with. It's such a great test of our hearts. I thank God for the times when He's asked me to wash the feet of a man that I wanted to throw a right hook at. I thank God that He asked me to sow all the money I had financially to a man anonymously that literally fired me. This is about love. It's no good if it's reciprocated. I mean, that's great. But are we working toward loving those who, quite frankly, aren't interested in loving us? Hey, they can do whatever that they want, but I want them to know the door's open here. Hey, I love you, man. You can do whatever you want to do, but if you ever come to me and you're ready, I'm ready to embrace you. Praise God. The offspring of the spirits of accusation and fault-finding are gossip and slander. Word the Holy Spirit gave to me. The offspring of the spirits of accusation and fault-finding are gossip and slander. Where there's gossip and slander, these two spirits have dominion. B, when saints have sin in their life. We all need correction in our lives. Amen? Yes. Three of us? We all need, I know the church is telling you you have to feel good every time. Leave Sunday. We all need correction in our lives. But the ministry of reproof must be patterned after Christ and not the accuser of the brethren. If the word of rebuke or correction does not offer grace for restoration, it's not the voice of Jesus Christ. If the word of rebuke or correction does not offer grace for restoration, it's not the voice of Jesus Christ. On the home stretch, hang with me. Holy Spirit, help us right now. Galatians 6:1 establishes protocol for addressing the sin in the life of another member of the body of Christ. Now, I simply have to tell you, I'm going to believe the best about everybody in this room, but there are legitimately people in the body of Christ who believe they have a gift of exposing the sins of other people. They find joy in it. They find laughter in prophesying about the sins of other people. They are in strong deception. Again, I'm going to tell you that the nature of a self-righteous heart is that it finds joy in the sins of others because it makes it feel good about itself. If you find yourself looking at others struggling and thinking, wow, I'm glad I'm not in their situation, you're probably under attack. If you find yourself wanting to go to the place of prayer and bear their burden, you're on the right track. Galatians 6:1, brethren, if a man is caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, throw him away. Don't talk to them. Don't pray for them. Let everybody know their sins. No, it says restore. Such a one in spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself, lest you too be tempted. Beloved, I'm telling you, this is the acid test right here. Number one, spirit of gentleness. In what spirit do we go to people that are in sin? Self-righteousness. I'm going to tell them because I have 40 years of experience and I've been around the block a time or two. I just want to just encourage even older people in the Lord, or as Marie has instructed me to say, more mature. It's a great thing when you can go to the next generation in a spirit of gentleness. Well, son, based off of my experience, and just cut all that out. In a spirit of gentleness, we approach those who are in sin. Here, number two, in humility, looking within, lest we too stumble. Look, this is a strong word. Before we go and chastise someone about their pornography problem or about whatever God has revealed to us about them, look within, lest you too stumble. Motive number three. This is it right here. To restore and heal, not destroy. To restore the motive. We go in the spirit of gentleness. In humility, lest we too stumble. Why do we go to them? To restore and heal, not destroy. I love that. What's it again? To restore, not to destroy. Love it when we see people in our community that are bound in sin, that are struggling in addiction, that their marriage is on the rocks. Go to them in gentleness, in humility, looking at your own stuff. And the motive is, God, use me as an instrument of restoration. I've got to be honest, I rarely see this, like ever. that a person's true heart behind confronting someone's sin is that they want to see them restored back to the place that they once were with the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, raise up a generation whose heart's cry is this right now. Love, I'm telling you, we have let so many gifted individuals slip through the cracks because we've had it all wrong. Yes, they sinned. Yes, they fell. But where were those who had a heart to restore? Well, and I'm telling you, some of these people, they're serving the devil right now. If I name them in Hollywood, a lot of their stories, pastors, kids, grew up in the church, they sinned and everybody said, now they're just influencing and working for the wrong boss. In Revelation 2 and 3, rebuke comes with praise and promise. I love this. Jesus even gave Jezebel time to repent. You get all these prophetic words, and the Lord says, if you don't turn or repent right now, you're going to hell. Jezebel's still hanging around in the book of Revelation. Jesus was even kind enough to her to give her an opportunity to repent. I thank the Lord for that. To be truly anointed to bring Christ's corrections to a church, one what must be anointed with Christ's motives. To be truly anointed to bring Christ's corrections to a church, one must be anointed with Christ's motives. Again, this is the acid test. This, you got to check yourself. What's my motive? What's my motive? What's my motive? Okay, Lord, you've put so-and-so in my heart. What's my motive? Am I glorying in their sin? Am I finding some type of perverted sense of joy? Or is my heart to restore them? Do I have your motives? I'm just going to throw this out there. I believe that there are many creatures in the body of Christ, honestly, that don't love the church. Their motives are impure. They find joy and satisfaction out of rebuking and proclaiming judgment when they're really not in love with those that they minister to and with. We will always be serving in churches where something is wrong. One more time, just in case you didn't get that. By the way, you're sitting in a very imperfect church. I still think Lakeland has some type of weird syndrome where I know hundreds of people in this city that are looking for a perfect church. We will always be serving in churches where something is wrong. Our response to what we see defines how Christ-like we are actually becoming. Our response to what we see defines how Christ-like we are actually becoming. If we see weakness in the body of Christ, our call is to supply strength. Where we see sin, our response is to exemplify virtue. When we discover fear, we impart courage. Where there is worldliness, we display holiness. Our assignment is to enter the place of need and stand there until the body of Christ is built up in that area. The truth is that the Lord has intentionally placed us in a world, in a church community that is, you got it, imperfect. Where we see something that is less than Christ, we are also seeing our opportunity to become Christ-like. Imagine that. Where we see something that is less than Christ, we are also seeing our opportunity to become Christ-like. Underline this next statement. The Lord doesn't want us to complain that the nursery carpet is dirty. He wants us to clean the carpet. I really don't want to go on a big rant here. Hallelujah. Trying to help you in this season of your life, some of us young people in years down the road. Okay? It's not some type of special anointing to be able to go into a church and see what they're doing wrong. Those are probably 75% of the emails I get, and I know probably many other people get them. Well, you didn't do so-and-so at service. Well, this wasn't right. Well, this isn't wrong. Well, here's always normally my first question. What are you willing to do about it? And about 75% of the time I hear crickets. It's one thing to point to a need. It's another thing to fulfill the need. If your church's greeting team stinks, get on the greeting team. If you can't stand the way the microphone sounds, buy a new one.
Amen.
I mean, it blows my mind. I mean, I'm telling you, we can lie. Hey, you want help with that?
No.
Because you're not helping. I mean, I've sat down with some people in my office. I mean, I've had people F-bomb me from this community. I mean, blah, 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 sitting next across from so-and-so. And I'm like, you know what? You're right. We stink at that. We're not good at that. Beep, 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 whatever he needed Jesus. And what are you going to do about it?
Well,
but I believe you are dead on. You are seeing exactly what we need. Can you help? This is so easy. Again, we've created this society where we sit back and we fire away and we're not ready to get off of our butt and be world changers. I mean, good grief, we've got people going to bash the church that they're not even a part of. Praying for them? Are you up?
Whatever. Praise the Lord.
He doesn't want us to criticize the worship leader, but pray for them. He doesn't want us to discuss how poor the pastor's preaching is. He desires we intercede for the pastor. B, seasons of pruning. We're on third base. Ninth inning. There are seasons in our lives when, in order to increase our fruitfulness, the Father prunes us back. This message will not attract the crowds. There are seasons in our lives when, in order to increase our fruitfulness, the Father prunes us back. This is a season of preparation where God's purpose is to lead His servants into a new level of power in their ministry. A lot of people have this wrong. Well, He's mad at me. What did I do wrong? Why am I in the wilderness? Actually, it's because He loves you enough to take you to the next level. John 15. The process requires a new level of surrender as well as an experience of crucifixion. It often brings humiliation, testing, seeming ineffectiveness as God expands our dependency upon Him. It can be a fearful time when our need is exposed in stark visibility. How many people have ever seen people go through this season? I mean, they are getting stripped down. You're like, man, how much more can they take? I mean, you know God's in it, and you know His hand is in it. You're like, Lord, how much more? The spirit of accusation sees a person's vulnerability as the perfect opportunity to crush them. The spirit of accusation sees a person's vulnerability as the perfect opportunity to crush them. During the incubation of dying to self, individuals who might otherwise have emerged with the clarity and power of prophetic vision are beaten down and abandoned by those who should have prayed them through to resurrection. they're going to make mistakes. Someone's probably going to get sick. They're probably going to work a job where they would rather do such and, I mean, we're around people every day. I know we're a new church plant, but, you know, part of what I've been watching over the last 5 years is just life. We've got people having babies. We've got people transitioning jobs. And we've got all sorts of stuff. But inevitably, in a family, in a community, things break down. People go through trials and hardships. We've got an opportunity in that moment to surround them and pray them through rather than in their moment of weakness, pick them off, crush them, so that they never make it to the season or the power that God wanted them to live in. I believe this happens all the time. People never step into the next dimension of life and ministry that God has called them into because the people around them are hoping and praying for their demise rather than their best. Because their best might be better than your best. What do you mean I'm supposed to be praying that people prosper more than me? What do you mean? I'm supposed to be praying that people get more blessed than me? That, oh, yeah. That's what will establish Christ's likeness inside of you. Praise God. See the prayer and blood of Jesus. Jesus prayed in John 17, Father, I pray that they are one as we are one. John Kilpatrick says this is the only prayer that Jesus prayed that hasn't been answered yet. Father, I pray that they are one even as we are one. In Revelation 12, Satan is cast down as the one who accuses the saints day and night. Jesus is praying for us. We know he's forever living to make intercession for us. Jesus is praying. Satan is accusing. Whose side are you on? I don't know that a lot of us picture Satan like this. I don't know that we see him as an accuser. Some of us know it because he does it to us incessantly, bringing up our past. He accuses us. He accuses us. He, night and day, stands before the throne of God. And there's Jesus, who's died on the cross for our sins, and says, no, my blood speaks a better word. Therefore, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But I can just get caught up in this, the enemy. They did this and they did that. And Jesus said, but I've forgiven them. But I've washed them. But I've made them clean. But I've given them a chance and I've given them 1,000 chances. Hallelujah. Some of us, they did this and they did that. And they did that and that and that and that. Some of us, we've made up so many reasons why we can't love people that we just obviously don't. But I just pray that you erase those files tonight. I know we just go on with our Christianity and go to church here and there and praise God. And we can say yes to Christ's likeness. Praise God. Here's what the Lord said to me today. We will never see the salvation, power, kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ come until the accuser of the brethren has been thrown down. I believe that every person in this room wants to see salvation. I believe you want to see power, and I believe that you want to see the kingdom of God and the authority of Christ established in our midst. I'm telling you, we will never see it unless we cast down the accuser of the brethren. Roman numeral 4, as we close, finding freedom. God the Father desires that his sons and daughters break agreement with the demonic spirits of accusation and fault finding and submit themselves to the intercessory heart of Jesus Christ in a love that covers a multitude of sins. Finding and submit themselves to the intercessory heart of Jesus Christ and a love that covers a multitude of sins. We must commit to continually cleaning out the filters of our hearts as we seek to minister the gifts of the Holy Spirit in love toward one another. Where there is accusation and fault-finding, the gifts of the Holy Spirit will not be exercised in purity and love. I'm not going to lie to you. I still believe you can move in the gifts of the Holy Spirit with accusation and finding fault in your heart toward others, but you will never minister in purity and at the level that Jesus Christ has called you to minister on. You will end up being collateral damage. You will bring destruction and not life. I'm going to tell you, we have had guests come to Heart of the Father ministry and never return. Why? Someone gave them a word that made them feel condemned and like they were worthless. Beloved, I get those emails more than you would think. Well, why aren't we praying for everybody? Why? Because there are people in our midst moving in the accuser of the brethren and the fault-finding spirit. Their heart's not full of love. They're not seeking to edify. And quite frankly, who knows why they came? Just gives me such a heart for those that would come to our community. The fact that people could leave here and not feel loved, not feel accepted, not being edified, it's a shame. Part of what this is doing inside of me is wanting just to, Lord, who can I edify today? Who can I love? Who can I encourage? Who can I build up? Lord, let me get in the prayer room and repent of my sins, my offenses, the things that I've got for another. I see letters right now. I see people in this room that need to write letters to so-and-so and cleanse your conscience. You must get the dead weight off of you in this season, says the Lord. For you are hindering my desires for your life by choosing to hold on to bitterness and unforgiveness. Yes, I know your pain, says the Lord, but my blood speaks a better word. I'm telling you, the Lord is speaking right now. You must get the dead weight off of you in this season. You must write them a letter and clean your conscience. I believe the Lord is saying to a couple in this room, it's time to write your parents' letters and release them to the Lord. Is our heart to restore or hurt those around us? Are we more easily given over to accusation and gossip or prayer for those who are struggling? Let us never lose sight of our own need for grace, mercy, and forgiveness. Beloved, if you can stay in this place, you can't lose. I'm telling you, if we continually stay in tune with our own debt that we owe Jesus, we will stop worrying about the debt other people owe him. The longer we've been saved, the more we lose sight of our own spiritual bankruptcy. We become the self-righteous police. We become like the Pharisees, hard on everyone else and blind to our own sin. We partner with the accuser. We partner with the fault-finding spirit. And I'm telling you, we need to repent tonight and get it out of here. As Jesus said, for if you forgive men for their transgressions, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men, then your Father will not forgive your transgressions. Yup, it could be talking about eternity. It felt as I prayed, just to simply say, the ball is in our court. Let us not be hearers of the word only, but doers. Let us seek in prayer tonight if Kelly could come up. Let us just seek the Lord on how we, as a body of believers, could ask the Lord to deal with us. I don't exactly know what's going on here. I don't know who has offense. I didn't come up with this message. I don't ever use the pulpit as a way to meddle with people's business. If I've got a problem with you, I would just come to you. If I'm concerned about your life, I would just come to you. But only you know what you're dealing with. Only you know what you're struggling with. I personally thought the Lord was explicitly saying to me, many people are dealing with issues against family members. I believe God wants to release freedom in that area. So will you bow your heads with me and let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. Father, we thank you for your mercy tonight. Wants to deal with this accusation, this fault finding. He also wants to deal with the truth of what we're seeing. What's our motive? Just hear the Father saying tonight, I never discipline my children to destroy them. I only discipline to restore them. My discipline will never be destructive in your life. It can only be redemptive. When I come in, says your Father, and I address and I begin to pick areas in your heart that are offensive to me, I'm going to give you grace tonight to see it as my love. You can receive this from God your Father. I just believe He's saying to you tonight, I love you. I'm coming after your heart in this season. Coming after your pain. Tears will bring healing to your life. The Lord says, I'm about to pop the pressure. Just let it go. Safe place for slander. showed me was like some pictures of some women who were literally addicted to the phone, talking to their girlfriends about so-and-so. God, we pray freedom in the name of Jesus from being addicted to talking about others.
Clarity.